I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Stanton Forbes' bizarre retrospective tale of entanglement. If two of them are dead. Starring Earl Holliman. Catherine Burns. And Nina Foch as Sister Love. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by Quaker State and Ford. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
This week, our story takes place in Midwest America, the Depression years. A lonely farmhouse in which three people come together under desperate circumstances. We are about to meet teenage Dorcas Kimball, her malformed leg a symbol of her bitter life of loneliness and deprivation. Joe John Plunkett, a young hobo, cynical beyond his years, resigned to empty days and nights of aimless wandering. His only goals in life, his next bed, his next meal. And the beautiful evangelist, Sister Magdalene Love, filled with godly zeal and cold worldly ambition. Three people joined by fate in an old house already occupied by violence and sudden death. Their story, If Two of Them Are Dead, begins after this word. Picture this. A string of freight cars crossing a dusty stretch of lonely farmland. Suddenly, the dark silhouette of a man hurtles in the train, dropping hard into the sharp cinders of the railroad. The man gets to his feet, slaps the dust from his clothes, finds where his bundle has landed and picks it up. The bundle contains all the man's worldly possessions. An extra shirt, some underwear and socks, a straight-edged razor in a worn leather case, and a small packet of letters addressed to Joe John Plunkett. At this moment, Joe John Plunkett is a hungry man. And a hungry man is ready to do just about anything to put some food in his belly.
This Plunkett look, all right. I could see that at a glance. At second glance, anyway. First, when I saw that big tent flapping in the wind in the field across the road, I thought, carnival. Rides and games, work and food. But soul food's what it turned out to be. Soul food for suckers. A revival meeting tent. People with nothing to put in their stomachs must be sitting ducks for some Bible thumper. Well, you deliver me. You're an out dog. And you're a stranger. Everywhere you go, dogs are poison. Probably take a hunk out of my own pair of pants. Get away, you little mutt.
Tippy? Come back here, Tippy.
Yeah, Tippy. Be a good pooch of am, Scraley.
Tippy?
And take her with you. I'm not in the mood for conversation with the farmer's daughter. Or anything else. Especially with some skinny little...
I'm sorry about Tippy. But she won't hurt you. She just likes to bark. Little dogs are like that. They think they got to stand up to anything that moves.
Yeah, well, I was just moving on.
Walking all the way into town. You looking for work? Are you hungry?
Yeah, I'm hungry. do for it. Something I could see that by the look of her. Edgy and eager. I've seen people who look like that before. They wanted something bad.
You any good with a jigsaw? Building things with your hands?
I don't plan on settling down here.
You see them things over there? Little painted windmills and wooden statues of Uncle Sam? My pa makes them to sell, only he took sick. Tuberculosis. He had to go to the sanitarium. I need somebody to make some more. It ain't too hard. And you have a place to sleep and something in your stomach. I don't cook so bad.
How old are you?
17.
What happened to your leg?
Infantile paralysis, but it don't hold me back now.
You all alone in the place with your paw gone?
That's right. I need somebody to help me. Just for a little while. You don't have to stay long. He was right. It was crazy taking in a strange tramp off the road. And looking into his face, I could see there was violence in him. Only for a second back there when he asked me about my leg, I felt gentleness, too. And a violent gentleman's just what I need. Anyway, I can't stand being alone no more. With Pa not here. Reckon I don't know your name.
Joe John Plunkett.
Mine's Dorcas. Dorcas Kimball. Where are your folks?
Dead. And if questions come with this job, forget it.
I was just being friendly. Ain't had nobody talk at all to you for 2 old days now. Tippy, Tippy, of course. Shut up, Tippy. This here's Joe John Plunkett. He's come to help. I cook a meal pretty good, don't I?
Well, a man half starves, no judge.
Never got no word out of Pa about my cooking either. He was always too liquored up.
Where's your Ma?
Dead a long time.
I'll go out and take a look at things in your Pa's workshop. See what I can do.
You've been to lots of places, I expect.
A few.
Ever been to Hollywood or New York? Places like that.
No.
Hollywood's got palm trees and sunshine. All pink and gold is the way I see Hollywood.
Yeah. Well, I was never in any pink and gold cities.
New York is silver and black velvet.
All the cities I've ever seen were the same color. Gray. I'm going out to the workshop. I'll eat you the price of one square meal at least.
I guess you seen the revival meeting tent down the road?
I saw it.
I don't want you to do no work in my pa's workshop.
What do you want me to do?
Take me to the revival meeting tonight. Want to see Sister Love.
Somebody remember what it said on the sign outside the tent. At tonight's service, there will be a special call for the lame and the halt. It's funny, I'd forgotten about her leg. But I didn't suppose she ever forgot it. Only I didn't see me escorting a cripple to a hallelujah meeting. But I'd like to have upchucked the whole damn supper and canceled all debts. Brother, you got into debt so easy, and there was nobody to remind you how hard it is to pay. Nobody.
I want to see Sister Love.
Sister Love? What, a lady of answers?
I've seen her picture. She's beautiful.
And you think she can make your leg whole again?
I didn't say that.
You're crippled. You might as well learn to live with it.
I am, ain't I? He couldn't hurt me. Didn't matter what he said. I was just so glad he was here. I wasn't alone anymore, just sitting and thinking about everything over and over. The thought about going to the church meeting, I hadn't planned that at all. I just seen the lights gone over at the tent. Seen them when he opened the back door to go out. They put the lights on early to attract people. And the thought just came to me like it was printed inside my head. Go to church and ask forgiveness.
What a strange little girl. asking a whole lot of questions, offering answers I couldn't quite believe. And then when she was saying nothing at all, just staring out from behind those green, green eyes. You thinking about your paw dying?
What?
You had a look on your face. He could, you know. Tuberculosis is serious, isn't it?
Yes. Only there's something worse than Pa dying. It's how he wasted his life. Drinking and ending up in a place like this. He never got anything from living.
How do you know?
I know.
So, okay. I'm going to take the woodcarver's daughter over to get blessed by the Lady Evangelist. Well, there wasn't a hell of a lot to ask. The meal wasn't that great, but to a hungry man, it was ambrosia. Ambrosia. There's a word. That's one of my mother's words. How'd a woman who used words like ambrosia ever get mixed up with somebody like my old man? I should talk. A real riding bum. Ambrosia was a worthless hunk of language, and a tramp like me was a worthless hunk of humanity.
Think my dress is okay?
I never thought of the Lord as caring much about what people wore.
Anyway, it's the only decent thing I got.
Okay, with you if I wash out my shirt?
Sure, you can hang it on the clothesline out and back. There's clothespins in the bag.
I'll wear my good spare. I don't figure the Lord is fussy, but maybe your sister Love is. It was hard to believe. That deserted tent I'd seen earlier was now alive with humanity. There was even a string of cars and trucks backed up along the road. Their headlights formed an arrow pointing the way to sister Love and salvation.
Every night I watched them come. So many people.
There'll be some places down in front. If you want a place to sit, you better get inside. Come on, people are always strange about sitting in the first row. Well, you want to see her good, don't you? Come on.
Welcome, sister Love. Thank you. Read your pamphlet. It tells you all about the legend of Sister Magdalene Love.
Yeah, I'll wait and see her for myself. Looking around, I thought I was already seeing her. That old lady with the faded blue eyes waving a paper fan into her flushed face. And the young man stumbling down the aisle on crutches. And the women in wheelchairs and the men hobbling on canes and all the others. Yeah, they were the lame and the halt. Broken in body and twisted in soul. The cross above the stage had just come on. A double line of young women in purple dresses and solemn-faced young men in shiny white suits and purple bow ties filed under it in precise formation. I had the feeling the minstrel show was about to begin when a white-bearded man in a white satin tuxedo made his entrance. He looked like the interlocutor.
Look, there's Brother Love. It says in the pamphlet he's her uncle. Both her parents were killed in the bus wreck down in Tennessee, and Sister Love prophesied it before it happened.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Sister Love welcomes you, and let us return her welcoming prayer, the prayer that will shake the heavens. Let us pray. And now, our brothers and sisters, I hear. Oh, yes, I hear Sister Love is coming. Enter, Sister Love. Love, enter. While we are held in thine embrace, there's not a thought attempts to rove. Each smile upon thy beauteous face fixes and charms and fires our love.
So that was Sister Magdalene Love. A face like carved ivory. Violet eyes. And red gold hair like a halo of flame around her head. Standing tall and queen-like in a flowing purple robe. But you know, it was the expression in her face that held you. Now that was a look you knew you'd never forget.
Brothers and sisters, let us pray. Lord, how secure and blessed are they who feel the joys of pardon sin. Should storms of wrath shake earth and sea, their minds have heaven and peace within.
Amen.
We see all their heads made up of innocence and love, and soft and silent as the shades, their nightly minutes gently move.
Amen.
While they're wretched, like worms and moles, lie groveling in the dust below. As you know, we have been in this place of Sodom and Gomorrah for 5 nights now. And each evening we welcome more lost sheep back into the fold.
Even Dorcas lifted her head and turned around sharply. The man was sitting across the aisle in the row just behind us. He was big and rough-looking, unshaven, and plainly drunk. Sister Law was staring down at him. The look in her eyes seemed to grow softer instead of harder.
You are troubled, dear brother!
Yes,
look, Sister Love's coming down off the stage.
Walking like a queen, Magdalene Love came down that aisle toward that heckler. The big man staggered to his feet.
Let me help you, brother.
And that's when it happened. As Sister Love reached out to the man, he drew back his arm to hit her. Now, I was sure he was going to hit her, and that's why I did it. I bolted from my seat, I shoved Sister Love out of the way, and I sent that drunk crash into the floor of the house.
No! No!
As soon as I did it, I knew I'd made a mistake. Oh, boy, a bad mistake. When you're a stranger in a place, there's one rule to remember. Never do anything to call attention to yourself. It always means trouble. And right about then, I knew I'd gotten me some big trouble.
I was right about the violence in Jerry Jones. When he jumped up and slugged that man, it all happened so fast. Joe Jones, are you all right?
Just sit back down, Dorcas. Everything's okay. It's a bad habit of mine. But anyway, I got no business.
Deputy's taking that man away. He's as lifted up as my pa ever was.
Now, everything is all right, brothers and sisters. Now, just return to your seats and let us pray for that unfortunate sinner. Now, those of you whose bodies are tortured and maimed, but who wish to cleanse and purify your souls, come forward that Sister Love may lay her hands upon you and give you the healing of her blessing.
Ye sons of men, the feeble race, exposed to every snare, come make the Lord your dwelling place and try and trust his care.
This is what you came here for, isn't it? Aren't you going up there?
No.
Then come on, let's get out of here.
Ah, there you are, boy. I've been waiting for you.
It was that fat deputy who'd taken the drunk away. Well, I knew I was in trouble. Every time I move, I'm in trouble.
Hey, what's your name, boy?
Joe John Plunkett.
And where do you live?
We live just up the road.
Oh, you, related?
We're cousins. First cousins. Joe John just came to stay a while with me and my pa.
You're pretty good with your fists, ain't you, Joe John?
No, not so good. I just took him by surprise. You know, he was drunk. I thought he was going to hit her.
I want to thank you, brother.
She came out of the shadows behind us with a burning halo around her head. Her voice thanking me sounded soft and sincere, only I caught a glint of something else in those violet eyes of hers. Something that told me she hated my guts for what I'd just done.
Hush up, Tico. Show me up. There's no way the deputy can find out I was lying. Even if he comes around asking more questions.
He might get to wondering where your pa is.
Well, I'll just explain to him about the sanitarium, that's all.
And what if he decided to check up on that?
He won't. Besides, Sister Love told him to leave you be. And you heard her. She even sent Brother Love to get that drunk out of jail.
Yeah? Sister love seems to be overflowing with brotherly love, all right.
So you can stay here as long as you want now, and you won't get in any trouble.
Well, I can use a good night's sleep. I'll go that far.
I was just thinking, maybe you'd like something to drink first. There's some of my pa's homebrew. It's in the cyclone cellar.
Well, I could use a drink for sure.
I'll get you the flashlight.
I was still trying to figure Dorcas Kimball out. Now, whatever it was she wanted out of me, she was still leading up to it.
Here, you can go down and bring up as much as you want.
Well, I sure didn't need that flashlight outside. The moon was full and the stars looked like they went on forever. I crossed the yard to the cellar door. It's so heavy, I wonder how Dorcas ever managed to open it. Yeah, the cellar was dark. I turned on the flashlight and started down. And then I saw what Dorcas Kimball had sent me down here to find. The dead body of her paw.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, If Two of Them Are Dead. I'm Rod Serling. The Depression years, a time of transience, a time when home was anywhere one spent the night. For Joe John Plunkett, home was a moving freight, rolling across the American Midwest. Or it was until he met Dorcas Kimball, 17, crippled and alone. Two young misfits in a ramshackle house, and a revival meeting just down the road. Nothing surprising for the time and place. But for Joe John Plunkett and Dorcas Kimball, the quest for salvation was destined to be a surprisingly dangerous proposition. If Two of Them Are Dead, we'll continue in a moment.
The body lay crumpled at the foot of the cellar stairs. Oh, I knew right away it was Dorcas's paw. And she'd sent me down here on purpose to find it.
You must have seen Paul lying there dead by now. He'd be coming back any minute. Well, what else was I going to do? I couldn't just say right out, there's a dead body in the cellar and I don't know what to do about it. I had to get help somehow. And Joe John Plunkett coming up the road with Tippy yapping at his heels, he seemed to be it. I was just going to have to get Joe John to help me, whether he wanted to or not.
That's some bad case of tuberculosis your pa has got.
Guess you knew as soon as you saw him lying there, it was my pa.
It doesn't matter who he is anymore.
It's my pa, all right.
What happened?
I reckon I killed him. Didn't mean to.
Well, thanks for the meal. I'll get along without the bed.
You go, and I guess I'll have to set that deputy on you. I'll have to explain how you aren't my cousin at all, how you came around begging for work, and my pa took you on because he wasn't feeling well, and you killed him.
What am I supposed to have killed him for? This thriving trade you're doing in wooden statues of Uncle Sam?
There's money hid in the cellar. It's mine. But I'll say you found out and killed Pa for it.
Well, you sucked me in good, didn't you?
What are we going to do with him?
You can't just dig a hole in the ground and throw him in like a dead horse. You think you can get away with this?
There ain't nobody who's going to miss him.
Well, you must have been one hell of a daughter.
I hated him. I didn't mean for him to die. I wanted to go to Sister Love's meeting to pray. I asked for forgiveness. But I didn't feel nothing at all.
Well, you managed to get me into your trap real good with that Sister Love business. That deputy's already got me pegged to somebody who hits first and thinks about it later.
I had nothing to do with that. You did that yourself. But I could have still used the same story since you're just a stranger here.
Well, when you're a stranger, you got no chance at all right? Everybody's against you right off.
So what are we going to do with it? My pa's body, I mean.
What do you mean? There's nobody to miss him. I mean, you got no kin folks at all?
There's just Pa and me, that's all. Ever since Ma died.
What about your neighbors?
Oh, Mrs. Buttleford down the road, though. She never comes near our place no more. She hated my Pa, called him a whiskey-breathing devil. If she thinks anything at all, she'll just figure he finally drunk himself to death.
Well, what about some old friend of your Pa's that might show up?
If there was any, they'd think the same thing. I thought he'd have no friends, only somebody to get drunk with now and then.
He doesn't owe anybody any money, does he?
Nobody give Pa credit.
How about the people that come here to buy these statues and things? I mean, you got any steady customers?
Nobody ever comes more than once. Anyway, I always wait on the people who come. Pa stayed in his workshop.
Yeah, well...
There's somebody you haven't even thought of.
This isn't a game. Who is it?
The census taker. Only he don't come but every 10 years, and he was just here a while back.
All right. Give me a shovel. Let's get it over with.
I want to change my clothes first. If I did it in this dress, I couldn't ever wear it again. And it's the only one I got.
Well, go ahead, but let's hurry up, will you?
We can bury him right there in the cellar. It's got a dirt floor. It'd be kind of like one of them mausoleums, you know, like they have in cemeteries. Of course, I can't put up a tombstone or anything like that. Maybe I can plant some flowers by the cellar door.
I really couldn't figure her out. She just killed her father somehow, unless he was worrying about planting flowers by his grave. Just then, she sounded like a scared little girl. Maybe that's all she was, all she'd ever been.
Let's go. I'm ready now. Brought along this old quilt to wrap him up in. Make it easier to handle him, I figure.
Well, I figured that was one weird manner of figuring. First she kills her old man, leaves him lying there for who knows how long. Then she wants to wrap him up like some kind of a birthday present. I figured it was bad luck and big troubles. Joe John Plunkett style. That wasn't daisies we were planting. If I went ahead with this thing, I'd be taking part in what amounted to murder. Well, I thought it over whether or not to help her out. I sure didn't feature getting mixed up in a murder. But I decided it was something I had to do. Now, a dead man's got to be buried.
His body isn't stiff. I thought it would be. Does it get stiff like I've read about and then get soft again before it starts to rot away?
Oh, you shut up.
I'm just nervous, that's all. Looks plenty deep to me.
Yeah, well, the deeper the better.
Ain't nobody ever come down here but Pa and me, and I won't ever want to come down again, knowing I'd be walking on Pa's grave.
Just shut up and let me dig in peace, will you?
Okay, I'll shut up. I had something else to think about anyway. The money. I hadn't been lying about that. I did have money hidden in the cellar. I could look at a place on the wall and know just which brick it was that was loose and had the money hid behind it. I couldn't let my Pa find that money. He'd have spent every cent of it on liquor and I wouldn't have had nothing left. Nothing in the world. My great Aunt Nadine had given me that money when she was dying.
Come here, girl. Don't be afraid.
How are you feeling, Green Aunt Nadine?
I'm dying. Cancer. Eating me up.
I remember now how the room had smelled like slow death.
My pillow. Reach under my bed.
And I pulled out a little beaded purse and seen what was inside. Shiny gold pieces. $300 worth turned out.
Now, the
don't let your pa...
They've been Great Aunt Nadine's last words.
Okay. You're going to have to give me a hand with him.
What?
Just help me get him under this quilt. Then we can just slide him into the hole.
All right.
No, I'll handle his head and shoulders. You just lift up his legs. Okay. Now, help me ease him down. There. That's done. The worst of it's done. You're not going to start crying for him now, are you?
I'm crying for him. It's my leg. It's hurting. And it ain't hurt me for a long time now.
All that's left now is just to cover that evidence like it's that fast enough. Not a minute at home who I come down for in the first place. Before we went back into the house, I made sure I had a couple of bottles of it under my arm. Only first, as soon as I got back into that kitchen, I filled the sink with water and stood there for a long time, washing my hands.
You want me to fix you something more to eat?
No, I think I'll just try some of your Paul's medicine.
Then I guess I'll go to bed. I've never felt so tired.
Yeah, it's been a long day.
Good night, Jojo. Thank you. I couldn't remember going to bed or falling asleep, and I had no idea what time it was the next day when I finally woke up. I only knew that I woke with just one thought. I hoped Joe John Plunkett was gone, gone for good. I didn't need him anymore. I didn't need anybody. Anybody here? Sorry to keep you waiting. Hush, Tippy.
Forgive me, dear. I wouldn't have acted so impatient if I'd known you were handicapped.
I was just changing my clothes, that's all. And I thought somebody else was here to answer the door.
My husband and I were admiring that large statue of Uncle Sam you have out there in the yard. How much are you asking for it?
Large Uncle Sam's $2.
Forget it, Marie.
But seeing he's a little faded, I'll let you have him for $1.50.
Oh, well, what do you think, George?
Jim cracks. All worthless, if you ask me.
Now, George, Hetty Burns has got a little wooden statue sitting in the middle of her petunia bed. Looks real smart.
Mm.
I tell you what, we'll take him off your hands for $1.
Well, that's giving it away. But all right, it's too hot to argue.
Pay her, George. Get it in the car. I want to get someplace for a frosted root beer before I melt.
Thanks, mister.
Don't thank me.
You should have held off with a buck and a half.
Thought you'd taken off for tall timber by now.
I figured I had some breakfast coming. Don't worry, I'm going.
Picked you up a mess of eggs.
Yeah, that'll do. I already put the coffee pot on.
Where are you heading?
Just as far away as I can get.
Me too, as soon as I can.
The money you got hidden in the cellar. I imagine you could go ways on that.
You ain't forgot about that.
Nobody forgets to mention the money. Look, you don't have to fret about me. I mean, I don't figure it's enough to walk over anybody's grave for.
That money's mine. It's got nothing to do with Pa.
Of course, you'll have to go back down there to get your money. Though you did say you'd never go there again, didn't you?
I said I won't ever want to. Well, I'll just have to one more time.
Is that why you killed him? Because of the money?
You couldn't understand. You didn't know him, what he was like. How it was to be stuck here all alone with him, never knowing what he was going to do next.
Gorkas! You hear me calling you, girl? I know you were down here. I seen you flitting across the yard and your skirts flying. You ought to be ashamed of yourself, girl. Getting too old to be running around showing yourself the way you do. Got that bad leg, but there ain't nothing wrong with the rest of you. You better watch yourself or you're going to wind up in bad trouble.
You leave me alone.
Hey! Ain't no way to talk to me. I'm your pa, remember?
Leave me be, pa.
Now, girl, I ain't going to... Not...
Get away from me, pa. I'm warning you.
Well, if it was so bad, why don't you just get away from us?
Huh?
You could have gone to the cops if your pa was mistreating you.
I thought of doing that more than once. But I couldn't. Couldn't have my own pa put in jail.
So you just killed him instead, huh? My heart bleeds for you.
You want more coffee?
No, I'd settle for a cigarette, though, if you had one. Then I'm going to hop the next freight out of here.
There's some Bull Durham in the cupboard if you can roll.
I can do anything when I have to. You all know that. Wouldn't you just know it? Here comes trouble.
What?
We got company. Your favorite sister just turned off the highway.
I don't have no sister.
Oh, yes, you do. She rides around in a big black Hupmobile.
You mean?
Yeah, I mean. Sister Love. And she's coming this way. Here for, I was sure it wasn't to thank me. She'd said her thank you last night. And I still remember that look of resentment in her eyes when she said it.
Good afternoon, my child.
She looked different than the way she looked under the lights in the tent. She was younger than I thought, but still not really young. Older than JoJo, I reckon. And she looked more real, not like a queen anymore. She had on a fancy dress, a lot of ruffles and ribbons.
May I come in?
I reckon you came to see JoJo. He's in the kitchen.
Could I wait in the parlor while you get him?
Oh, sure. You sit there on the davenport. I'll go tell him.
Bless you, my child.
So what does she want?
To see you, just like I said, she's waiting in the parlor.
Yeah, well, you just let her wait. I'm going to finish my cigarette in peace first.
I suppose I ought to offer some tea or something.
How about some of your pa's homebrew?
Well, that's not as funny as you think. You seen the way she's dressed?
Well, you don't expect her to go around in that purple preacher's robe all the time, do you?
Never mind. You just get in there and find out what she wants. Why don't you? I'll bring the tea.
As you can understand, Mr. Plunkett, traveling around the country as I do, incidents such as last night's are bound to occur from time to time. Of course I don't like to have such unfortunate souls as that poor man arrested and placed in jail on my account. In fact, I had Brother Love go right into town and put up bail so he could be free to go on his way.
Yeah, you sure that was smart? He could come back and make trouble for you.
Exactly. Ironic as it may seem, people do not always appreciate being saved. Indeed, they sometimes resent me for trying.
I can understand that, all right.
Oh, and that's why I've come to ask you to help me, Joe John Plunkett.
Me?
What is it that you want Joe John to do?
Goodness, child. I thought you'd gone off someplace.
I fixed you some tea.
That's very kind of you. But if you don't mind, I'd like to talk to Mr. Plunkett privately.
This is my house, not his.
She's right, you know. This is her house. And I'd kind of like to hear the answer to that question she just asked you. Seems I never know what people are likely to ask me to do next.
We will be leaving directly after the services tonight. And I want you to come with us. As my bodyguard.
Your bodyguard?
$20 a week. And your room and board.
He can't. Joe John's working for me. He's going to run the jigsaw. I'm going to pay him $25 a week. You're staying here, aren't you, Joe John?
Well, if the money's not enough, Mr. Plunkett,
the money's okay. It's more than I'm worth. No, thanks.
You have other fish to fry?
It ain't like that between Jojo and me. It ain't like that at all.
Oh, child. I wasn't insinuating anything.
No, look, what I don't see is why you're so set on me joining up with you. I mean, that don't make sense. I'm a bum. I mean, don't you know a bum when you see one?
You don't have to be a bum.
Oh, yes, I do. I have to be. I mean, I'm made for it. I work at it. Some people work for success. I work at being a failure. There are people like that, you know?
Sit down, Joe John Plunkett.
Look, don't think you're going to try to convert me.
Sit down, I said. As a matter of fact, I was only testing you.
Testing me?
I wanted to see what you were made of. In my profession, as you know, I deal with a lot of weak people.
You mean cripples?
Mental cripples. People who come to me begging for help. People who could help themselves, but they won't. They come to me looking for the easy way, something magic and quick.
But to help people, no matter what, isn't that wonderful?
Of course it's wonderful, child. That's my purpose in life, my burden and my joy. But it hasn't come easy. I've worked hard, striven ceaselessly toward my goal, to reach as many people as I can. And now I need help. Help that I can't get from a weak man. I need your help, Joe John Plunkett. And yours too, child. What's your name?
Dorcas Kimball, but...
You said this was your house? Is there anyone else living here besides you?
No, nobody else except for Joe John. Why?
Because this place is perfect for what I have in mind.
Oh, now, finally we cut bait, huh?
I have a mission. I can do good in this world that no one else can do. I have a message that is the power and the glory, and I must be heard by everyone. And I've chosen the two of you to aid me in my mission.
Well, how? What do you want us to do?
I want you to kidnap me.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour. Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, If Two of Them Are Dead. I'm Rod Serling.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Eastman Kodak Company and Quaker State Motor Oil. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow. And once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.